I'm Stephanie Banchero, the Director of the Education and Economic Mobility Program at the Joyce Foundation in Chicago. We're excited to have you join us for this session today. This session will focus on teacher shortages and other school staff shortages. The evidence is clear that teachers play a critical role in student success. They motivate students, they help strengthen their self-esteem, and of course, build their academic skills. Unfortunately, throughout the pandemic, many school districts have faced significant challenges attracting and retaining teachers and attracting and retaining other vital school staff, such as counselors. These shortages have direct impact on educational opportunity and outcomes for students. And research shows that educator shortages disproportionately impact students of color, students from low-income background, students with disability, and students from rural communities. Secretary Cardona recently released a call to action for state policymakers, higher education leaders, and school districts to use the pandemic relief and recovery funds to address the shortages. He has called on teacher preparation programs and school districts to work together in innovative ways to address staffing challenges. This pandemic has taken a toll on our schools and our young people. Fully staffing schools with top-notch, diverse teachers, principals, and counselors is where our recovery begins. And so now, on to our great presenters. First up, we have Penny Schwinn, the Tennessee Commissioner of Education. Penny will discuss Tennessee's unique Grow Your Own apprenticeship teaching model. Then, Kent Reed and Michelle Miller from the Kansas Department of Education will talk about their innovative Grow Your Own model for school counseling. And finally, I'll lead a panel discussion about an inventive virtual teacher mentoring program in Illinois with Carmen Ayala, the State Superintendent of Education, Audrey Soglin, Executive Director of the Illinois Education Association, and Amber Sims, a preschool teacher in Illinois. And now over to Penny.
Good morning. My name's Penny Schwinn. I'm the Commissioner of Education in the great state of Tennessee, and happy to talk a little bit about Tennessee's Grow Your Own Apprenticeship teaching model. As we know, throughout the country, we are facing an educator shortage, and that challenge is in Tennessee just as it is everywhere else. In Tennessee, we have approximately 1,000 vacancies and 10,000 students without a credentialed math teacher in front of them each and every year. So as a state, we really wanted to tackle a solutions orientation around how we might move forward in terms of decreasing those educator shortages and really strengthening that pipeline. The areas that are most affected in Tennessee really include ESL, science, math, and special populations. When we think about those challenges to entering the profession, we see that becoming a teacher is costly, whether that's getting your master's degree, your credential, and for many of our folks, it's also just your junior and senior year of college. It's becoming more and more expensive to enter into the profession. We also know, looking at our data, that new teachers are unprepared for the realities of the classroom. A lot of that is because the number of hours that our new teachers spend in classrooms with amazing mentor and master teachers is quite low for what they actually need in order to be ready on day one. And we also know that a priority in Tennessee is to ensure that we are diversifying the profession and we have teachers that reflect the communities that they serve. So when we thought about some of those solutions, Grow Your Own model is something that we've expanded over time. We had an initial investment, which included $2 million in state grants, and that was funded through the ARP funds. We were able to use those one-time federal relief funds to really build out infrastructure in the state and really expand our Grow Your Own programs. While our original Grow Your Own program launched in 2019-20 in a partnership with Clarksville-Montgomery School District, we've now expanded through the pandemic to 65 Grow Your Own partnerships using that ARP funding. That also includes 14 educator preparation providers, or EPPs, across the state. And those partnerships between our school districts and our EPPs has really allowed us to move this work forward and show a lot of success. Some of those programs that you're seeing are teaching as a profession. When we think about our high school students, we want to ensure that all of our high school students who are thinking about the great profession of teaching have an opportunity to get some early credits and experience while still in high school. We used ARP funds for innovative school models, and some of those are teaching as a profession models. And that allows for our future teachers in high school to really enter into programs, start to earn early credit, and actually provide and get experience with highly trained, either paraprofessionals, highly trained teachers, and really work with our youngest students. We have EPP innovation grants as well. Those were funded and awarded using ARP funds. And that is really to ensure that our ed prep providers have what they need in terms of content and coursework to prepare our teachers to be successful on day one. We used ARP funds for our original Grow Your Own programs, and right now we have 650 future educators in 65 programs, and all of this infrastructure across those programs was using our ARP funding. This one-time funding allowed us to build the programming that will then continue forevermore. But as you can see, just in these first 3 years, we were able to have more than half of our teacher vacancies now filled over the next 3 years, and that's an incredible amount of progress for our state. One of the things we'll spend more time on today is the teacher occupation apprenticeships. And this was done in partnership with the U.S. Department of Labor and the U.S. Department of Education. And it really is one of the most important components of our Grow Your Own program, because it's how we were able to use the one-time federal funding into a sustainable source of funding forevermore to ensure that you can become a teacher in Tennessee for free and get paid to do so. A couple of other components to our Grow Your Own program, though, are our endorsements. We have special education endorsements as well as ESL endorsements. Again, using that one-time ARP funding, it allowed us to establish programs that are low cost or no cost for existing teachers. So we wanted to ensure that those folks who are already in classrooms or already doing this great work in schools, who wanted to broaden their portfolio and opportunities, that we could pay for them to get additional endorsements to fill those high need areas. So we have 5,525 seats available for existing educators to be able to get that endorsement in things like special education, STEM, and ESL, where some of our major vacancies are. So if there's a surplus of, let's say, elementary school teachers in one district, those same teachers can get this endorsement for free and fill some of those existing vacancies. And then finally, we have a number of networks. We didn't want to limit it just to educators and teachers. We really wanted to ensure that we had strong leadership at the building level. And so we have an aspiring assistant principal and diverse leader network that serves over 700 educators in the state. And it's ensuring that we have at least one person in every district who is able to get their administrative credential and their master's at no cost, so that we have a strong pipeline of future principals and assistant principals ready to serve in our schools. But one of the things that we're most proud of, and one of the things that we are really leaning into, is being the nation's first federally approved teaching apprenticeship model. And so Tennessee was the first to submit to that, and we now have teaching as a federal apprenticeship. And this is really important for the pipeline, because we know that with the barriers to becoming a teacher, whether that is a financial barrier or whether there are just life challenges, we know a lot of folks want to go into teaching. They might be career changers. Maybe they didn't finish college, but they have their AA. We want to ensure that they have a pathway into the profession. And so this program allows for teaching to become an apprenticeable profession. It leverages federal funding resources, and those are federal resources that come in every single year that you can use. And it also allows us to really monitor quality and emphasize what we know is best practice to becoming a teacher. So when we think about some of the things that are the most important in terms of meeting employers' needs, we know that our employers really want on-the-job learning for real-time growth and development. They want to ensure that teachers on their first day of instruction have exactly what they need in order to be successful with students. We also know that teachers will enter the classroom with lots of experience. And so in the apprenticeship model, they have 3 years of practice and experience under a mentor or master teacher before that first day of having a classroom of their own. It also ensures that they have an expedited program that works based on competency. So as they master different skills and knowledge bases and pedagogical practices, they're able to advance at the rate at which they develop. And it also meets national quality standards. We want to ensure that when we are thinking about folks who want to become a teacher, we are maintaining high rigor and providing the amount of support that's necessary for them to be successful. When we think about what it means to have that registered apprenticeship in terms of those standards, there are a couple of things that really are critical. So one is you have to have employer involvement. You have to ensure that employers, which are school districts, have the foundations in terms of their support to register each and every apprentice. It also means that our districts are really the leaders in this work. They identify the teachers who are future teachers. They make sure that they are filling out the right paperwork, and they make sure that they've done that really important scan or screen of what their local needs are, and then fill those needs with the folks in their communities. The second is structured and on-the-job training. We want to ensure that the job-embedded training and support is the hallmark component of the apprenticeship program. That means that folks are really in classrooms, again, with our mentor and master teachers all day. They're being paid as paraprofessionals, and then they take classes at night to really support and elevate the practice and experience that they got during the day. That related instruction and how that comes together and combines is really, really important, because what it does is it means that someone's in the classroom, they're learning these really incredible practices under one of our master teachers, and then they're able to engage in that instruction and put those two things together. The compensation is a really important point, especially when you think about paraprofessionals or career changers. Lots of folks who want to become teachers, maybe they're in a different job. We've seen actually our paraprofessionals, bus drivers, custodians, people who've always dreamed of being a classroom teacher and have the knowledge and skills to do so, but life happens. And maybe they have families they have to take care of. They might have other financial responsibilities, and they just cannot afford to stop working and go back to school. This allows them to continue to be compensated, and they're compensated at higher and higher rates for every year that they're in an apprenticeship. And then they are able to support their families and get into that dream profession that they've always wanted. And then finally, it's a national occupation credential, and that brings with it a number of different benefits. When you're a federally recognized apprentice, you have so many other benefits that are above and beyond what a traditional pathway would offer. And so that nationally recognized credential is a really important part of the program. So when we think about how this benefits our future educators, we know that it's a proven model for developing future teachers. We also know that there are tax incentives and additional federal resources. One example that I can provide is that we had a teacher or future teacher in the program, and her car broke down. She had kids that she needed to take care of. She needed to be able to get to work. And because she was a federally recognized apprentice, she's able to have her car bills taken care of. She was able to have the apprenticeship dollars cover her Uber and childcare. So it really helped to support and elevate her, and also to ensure that she was able to be successful in her program. We've talked a little bit about the quality standards and the national credentials, but it really is important to note that this is maintaining high quality programming and emphasizing the importance of being in classrooms and getting that hands-on experience. And the earn as you learn, of course, is incredibly important for anyone who wants to become a teacher and certainly has other obligations or responsibilities. So when we think about that programmatic design, one of the things that we've seen is Clarksville Montgomery. They are our hallmark and first program. And their model was designed to address teacher recruitment, retention, and quality. So they really looked at target populations and their paraprofessionals and their teaching as a profession students. So the high school students and the paraprofessionals in their building. Their academic structure is, as I mentioned before, attending school in the evening. And those courses are completely paid for. And then they also have that employment in the school system during the day. And those are folks who are paid as instructional aid who study under that mentor or master teacher. So our paraprofessionals who are in these programs earn a living wage. They leave their programs with zero debt, and they have experience of at least 2 years before their first day in the classroom. And one of the things that we've noticed about the Clarksville Montgomery program, again, using the ARP funds to be able to expand that very quickly, is that they had a teacher shortage of about 80 teachers in 2019-20 going into the pandemic. They recognized that their critical areas of shortage were in elementary and special education. So what they did is that they identified people who might be interested in going into one of those two pathways, and they established the Early Learning Teacher Residence Program. This was in partnership with one of their local colleges, and explicitly addressed the district's needs. They identified those 80 teachers to meet the vacancies that they had in the district. This accelerated a free or no cost path to becoming a teacher in 3 years, and they identified 20 high school students and 20 district aides for their inaugural program. They've now branched that out to 80, and they're actually at 160. So they are producing more teachers through their Grow Your Own program than even the vacancies that they have at their local school district. This provided certainly a competitive pool of applicants. It is a very diverse pool of applicants. And what we're seeing in terms of their coursework completion and success, what we're seeing in their praxis exams and success, is showing that the additional support that they get on top of their experience during the day and their coursework, but all of the other supports that the district provides, is setting up each of those candidates to be even more successful on their first day of teaching than they otherwise would have been. And I think when we think about Grow Your Own, looking kind of at that one pilot program, we want to address 5 different buckets. We know that there are lots of people who might be interested in becoming a teacher, and we want to ensure that we are maximizing and emphasizing that school pipeline. So we look at our high school students, teaching as a profession. We have a number of high school students who are still thinking about what they want to do when they graduate from high school. And so we want to make sure to introduce them into education and what it means to become a teacher. We know that we have a number of students in college. We are also really targeting that freshman and sophomore year. What we've seen in the data is that by freshman year, many of our freshmen have already just crossed out the professions they don't want to do. Maybe they don't know what they do want to do, but they certainly are starting to eliminate options and choices. We want to ensure that teaching stays on their radar. And so introducing this pathway provides a different look at what it might become to be a teacher, leaving college without debt, being able to earn a living while you're in college as a paraprofessional doing the work that you love. And so we think there's a lot of opportunity there. We know we have school-based staff. And one of the things we've really challenged folks on is that, you know, we have paraprofessionals and a number of districts pulling from that. But like I said, you have custodians, you have bus drivers, you have school nutrition staff, people who very candidly are often overlooked. And I think that one of the things that we have to challenge ourselves on is saying that these are all people who might want to become teachers, who have the knowledge and skills and capabilities and are in their jobs for a number of reasons. But it's about ensuring that anyone who goes through this program and meets those high expectations, they are qualified to be a teacher, and we should support them to be able to live out those dreams they have. And there are a number of really impactful stories that I've heard about folks who, you know, maybe came from a low-income community, first in their family to graduate from high school or go to college. And this is providing that pathway to continue to lift them in their profession and think about what they might want to do. Fourth, we have career changers and retirees. We hear these stories about scientists and engineers and doctors and lawyers who really just want to get in the classroom and then see just how expensive it is. And it's a hard sell to say, take a really significant pay cut and then pay to have the privilege of being in education. And what we want to say is we want all of these wonderful people in our classrooms, and we need to remove those financial barriers in order to do so. And so career changers is one big opportunity. And we've got a number of early retirees who are also taking advantage of this. Some future areas are principals, assistant principals, supervisors, specialists. You can imagine grow your own counselors, grow your own social workers, grow your own bus drivers. And so we look forward to continuing to partner with the U.S. Department of Labor and U.S. Department of Education on a number of different pathways to ensure that we are fully staffed in our public schools, that we have an option that provides zero debt and compensates people so they can support their families. All of those are critical. And I'll just emphasize that none of that would be possible if we didn't have this initial funding, this one-time funding to get these programs off the ground, because they are self-sustaining, especially the apprenticeship model, but you have to have the initial funds. And in Tennessee, we've really looked at this collaborative solution and thinking about one-time funds as sustainable funds. How do we ensure one-time money starts to work forevermore? And it really is establishing these initial programs that have a different source moving forward. But that ensures that everybody's working together. So we have our labor and workforce development who help us with the apprenticeship model. We're giving training and supports to our local workforce boards to ensure they understand their role and how they can best support the folks in their communities. We have a number of people who want to be aspiring educators, so letting them know the opportunities. Our district leaders and the professional development they need to know how to match their vacancies with the people in the communities who can do that work. Our ed prep programs and providers who really need support and how to think differently about how we prepare our future teachers. The state agency, which becomes the quality control and helping to bring all of these folks together. And then most importantly, our schools and communities. At the end of the day, this is about ensuring every child in the state of Tennessee and every child in the United States has access to an excellent teacher in front of them every day, high quality materials, and the supports and resources necessary to thrive. So what Tennessee is doing finally in terms of support and using our one-time ARP funds is that we believe that these are taxpayer dollars from across the country that we are receiving, and we want to provide that support in kind. So we'll have a Grow Your Own Apprenticeship playbook and workbook that will be available in May, and that will walk any district or state leader or workforce board through what is necessary in order to set up your own programs. This will also be available for our APP so that they know what they need to do to partner with their local school districts. We'll have a future website tool available to help future candidates, whether you're a teacher, a paraprofessional, a career changer, retiree, et cetera, navigate how to become a teacher and make it very clear. And a number of additional resources, case studies, and one-pagers that can help folks navigate how to become a teacher and how to support people in their communities to become a teacher. So please be on the lookout in Tennessee for all of the great resources coming up. But ultimately, without these ARP funds, we would not have been able to move this quickly and do this amount of work. And so we're very grateful for the opportunity to have a different pathway and a different look at how to become a teacher, best practices that will deliver exceptional education to kids, and certainly strong use of one-time funds that will have a sustaining and lasting impact for the students in this country. So thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Michelle Miller. I am the Director of Teacher Licensure and Accreditation for the state of Kansas. Happy to be a part of this conversation talking about how America's Rescue Plan is supporting America's students and the work that we have completed in Kansas. So I'll give a brief synopsis. In late fall, September, October, we began a conversation with our state board and with our superintendents about what options might be the most helpful for our school systems in order to continue to cover classrooms as children were integrated back into the what we would call normal educational setting. And what our superintendents told us about our substitutes specifically was that they would support 18-year-old high school diploma candidates entering the profession on a temporary basis. About 60% of them said that. And on a permanent, as they also said, as a permanent solution, 55% of them would support some type of a license for a candidate who didn't have what we normally consider for a substitute license to be 60 hours on a transcript. But this was an interesting conversation, and I would advise anyone else who is looking at this option to take my advice and not advertise the 18-year-old piece, because there are no districts in Kansas that would hire anyone under 18-year-olds to supervise students. So that just created sort of a PR nightmare for us to talk about that 18-year-old piece. So typically in Kansas, what the norm has been was that candidates for substitute licenses had to have 60 college credit hours earned from a regional accredited college or university. Every candidate, no matter what, has to pass the fingerprint and background check, which is the full KBI, Kansas Bureau of Investigation background, and the full Federal Bureau of Investigation background as well. There is an application process and also an application fee. So the state board waived the number of days for the traditional substitute license that any of those candidates could serve, and also implemented an option for candidates to come in as substitutes without those 60 hours. And I'll talk a bit more about that, I believe, as we move on. But this type of sort of meeting the needs of our districts, this flexibility is happening in states that are near us as well. And you can see our neighboring states and some of their requirements. And again, they many of them require that fingerprint and background check, but there's some variation on what happens from state to state. So we went to the state board, asked them to make a motion due to the fact that there was an unprecedented shortage of substitute teachers during the pandemic, to create an opportunity for a candidate to be 18 years old, undergo the fingerprint and background check, And it was a partnership with the hiring school district. So for example, if a school district had a lunchroom supervisor that was 18, 19 years old, who they wanted to use in a very temporary basis to also cover some classroom settings, that candidate needed to partner with that local education agency to complete the background check and guarantee that this candidate would be used in that very temporary nature. And those licenses are set to expire June 1 of 2022. Just as a follow-up, we will be headed to the state board to ask for possible flexibility in this area with some, as you saw earlier, some training opportunities for this type of license to continue, but not without some level of support and training and opportunity to learn what it means to actually be in a classroom and responsible for students. I wanted to take a minute to just share a bit of history as we return to more normal situation with our traditional or what we have considered vacancies over the last several years. We knew that we were going to have vacancies over time prior to the pandemic, but as the data bears out, that has become an even higher issue of priority for our state. We cannot keep our special education positions filled. We cannot keep our elementary positions filled. Now we are experiencing that at the elementary level, where it had just basically been at content areas at English, language, arts, math, and science. And you can see that these are our five top vacancies. And what we have noted in the spring is that systems were not able to fill their fall vacancies and, in fact, have higher vacancies in the spring. So our data bears out that, indeed, this is a bit of a crisis situation for us in Kansas. There are alternative routes in our border states, and we are considering some of those opportunities. Kansas does not have any non-traditional routes to the classroom. In other words, all of our teachers in Kansas are prepared traditionally through our educator preparation institutions, institutions of higher ed. But you can see that Kansas, or that Texas, has 22 non-higher education alternative routes. Missouri has 4. Iowa has 2. Nebraska has 2. Colorado has 2. And it is evidenced as well that Oklahoma has 4 non-higher education alternative routes as well. So I know this was a very short synopsis, but we are working to create opportunities as a result of the pandemic that are lasting and that are not just quick fixes due to the pandemic. We've known we've had a teacher shortage issue in Kansas, and our direction from the state board is to continue to provide alternatives, opportunities for them to discuss ways that we can get wonderful adults in front of kids in Kansas and still maintain a high level of quality. At this time, I'll turn the presentation over to my colleague, Kent Reed.
Well, hello. Thank you very much for joining us today. And what I will do is talk about the implications of what Dr. Miller mentioned to school counseling. I am the school counseling consultant. First of all, this is the vision of our state board, that we would lead the world in the success of each student. And these are our state board goals. Now, this is relevant because each one of those goals is in our school counseling standards. So the work of school counselors is very important to the progress of education in the state. Ratios do matter. The recommended ratio for schools relative to students and counselors is 250 students to one counselor. And you can see that we're well behind that recommended ratio, not only relative to school counseling, but also to school psychologists and school social workers. I mentioned the school counseling standards. There are three domains in the school counseling standards: the academic, the career, and the social emotional. And when we were talking with Larry before we actually started this particular video, he wanted to know a little bit about how we're framing social emotional. Well, you'll see that the area shaded that overlaps the academic career and social emotional, we have labeled as employability skills. That's one focus of social emotional learning that we really have stressed here in Kansas, and that would be the development of employability skills. So what are we going to do with the shortage? Well, Kansas schools are currently facing a supply demand challenge, as Dr. Miller alluded to, with fewer licensed school counselors than there are school buildings. So what we encourage schools to do is consider a grow your own model by identifying a committed staff member who has the skill set necessary to become an effective school counselor. And then we provide this guidance. Number one, they must be concurrently enrolled in an approved school counseling graduate program. I think, Dr. Miller, we have 7 or 8 in the state of Kansas. They must be referred to as a student services coordinator. And the reason for that is ethical and legal issues. They are not licensed, so they can't be called a school counselor, but they can be called a student services coordinator until they qualify for the provisional license, which occurs after they've completed half of their graduate program. Establish a professional development plan with the candidate that familiarizes them with, number one, the school counseling standards, a document that we have put together called the Comprehensive School Counseling Program, our Kansas Social Emotional Character Development Standards that I'll show you in a moment, and a document that helps schools understand how to measure social emotional growth. We are a flat act state, which revolves around suicidal ideation. We have a bullying statute that counselors are responsible for implementing, and of course, mandated reporting. And we'll talk a little bit more about that here in a second, okay? We also would recommend that a mentoring program be established with either a licensed school counselor already in district, at a local education service center, or a local post-secondary institution or community mental health center, okay? The American School Counselors Association has a wonderful website that is all about legal and ethical responsibilities, and that really helps these candidates understand what those might be. And of course, we're always available to help with technical assistance. All right, I mentioned social-emotional character development. We were the second state to adopt SEL standards and the first to embed character development. Now, I'll point to the character development standard and the core principles. Those three statutes that I mentioned fall under the core principles, but really the core principle relates to what a district and a building decides is most important in terms of social emotional learning, what student competencies they want to focus on. And then we have personal skills and social skill development. Again, they were adopted in 2012. In 2018, we revised them and included the prevention statutes I mentioned, employability, which is a career domain, merging with the social emotional domain, school mental health, civic engagement, and mandated reporting. One of the tools that we provided them through various funding opportunities, and Dean can talk more about this, is the Kansas CAN competency framework. And that's brought to us by research collaboration, Dr. Patty Noonan and Dr. Amy Gomer Erickson at the University of Kansas. And here's a better picture of it. And essentially, the intrapersonal would be the social domain. Intra would be within oneself. Inter would be between two people. And what Amy and Patty did is they brought to us the cognitive domain. And this really helps classrooms teachers who may be focused on academics and they don't understand how to blend SEL in. Well, time management, problem solving, creative thinking, critical thinking, all of those will increase academic skills, but they are employability and social emotional skills as well. Here's a tool that we utilize. It's a competency sequence, pre-K through 12. And essentially, it takes the 6 most often requested competencies relative to technical assistance and breaks it down into a sequential framework. One of the other things that we do is we have a couple of different partnerships with CASEL, which is a collaborative for the advancement of social emotional learning. And the most current one is a workforce development partnership. And this is one of the tools you will find in the case study that will be published in about a week or two. And you'll notice that what we've tried to do is explain activities that will help workforce development skills from K all the way through 12. We have converted our standards to student competencies, and we did that during the pandemic to help schools understand what really needs to be focused on. This is the document I referred to as to how to measure social-emotional growth locally, and we use an MTSS framework to do that. Some of the data we collect through social-emotional is attendance, program completers, bullying incident data, suspensions, expulsions, and emergency safety interventions. And Dean is with us on the live chat. If you have questions about the specifics and the mechanics of ESSER funding, you might drop that in the chat and let him address that. And here's our contact information.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Stephanie Banchero. I am the director of the Education and Economic Mobility Program at the Joyce Foundation. We're a private foundation based in Chicago, and we invest in evidence-informed policies that advance racial equity and economic mobility for the next generation in the Great Lakes. For decades, many decades, we have focused on policies that support educators and that ensure that students of color and students from underserved communities have diverse and highly effective teachers and principals. And like many of the speakers that you've heard from today, we have become increasingly concerned about the effects of the pandemic and what it's done to young people, but also the effects on the teacher workforce. As we all know, it has not been an easy few years for teachers. So we've been working with districts and states to help them spend the COVID relief funds strategically, especially when it comes to teacher pipeline and retention issues. So I'm very excited to be here today to showcase some excellent work being done in my home state of Illinois. So joining us today are Carmen Ayala. She is the state superintendent of education in Illinois. She has spent nearly four decades in education. She started as a teacher, became a district superintendent, and for the last 3 years, she has been the state superintendent, and it's been a very lively 3 years. Also joining us, Audrey Soglund. She's been the executive director of the Illinois Education Association for nearly 13 years. That is an NEA affiliate. And Audrey also began her career as a teacher. And then finally, I am super excited that we have Amber Sims here. She is a second year preschool teacher at Gilson Brown Elementary School. That's in Alton School District, but we would say downstate Illinois, very near St. Louis. And she is going to give us the firsthand view of what it's been like to teach during COVID. So we're lucky to have her. We're going to spend our time today talking about a few initiatives that Illinois launched with the federal COVID relief funds to ensure that we have a strong pipeline of teachers, but also to support the current teachers in the field. And then we're going to take a deep dive into one specific effort. It's a very cool and unique partnership between the state and the teacher unions that's focused on mentoring of new teachers like Amber. So I'm going to kick it off by turning it over to the superintendent and asking you just to give a sense of the teacher shortage issues in Illinois. Like, what are the issues that we're looking at?
Thank you, Stephanie. Thank you for having me here today. And it's an honor for me to share the story about our efforts here in Illinois. The federal pandemic relief funding has had a tremendous impact on our schools, our teachers, and most especially our students. Illinois has made huge advancements towards strengthening our teacher workforce. We enacted historic school funding reform in 2018, and that funding increased the adequacy and equity of school funding. And since that time, the state has increased its investment in public education by more than $1 billion. And our districts have added more than 5,000 teachers to the profession. So according to some preliminary data from this school year, we added another 5,600 teachers to the profession this year alone. And that's almost 12,000 more teachers in just 6 years. Now, we still have more than 2,000 unfilled positions, but our statewide teacher vacancy rate is 1.5%. And that means that those 2,000 unfilled positions are concentrated in certain hard-to-staff schools and subjects. We're talking about our very rural schools, our special education cooperatives, our bilingual education classrooms, and our chronically low-performing schools. And we're talking about a shortage of teachers of color, and we're talking about an issue that is deeply rooted in equity. So our teacher workforce efforts in Illinois are focused on building local pipelines of talent, especially in low-income and rural areas, as well as boosting our recruitment and retention of teachers of color and teachers in special education and bilingual education.
So super helpful. We're going to take a dive a minute into the specific efforts that you launched with the recovery funds, but maybe can you just talk a little bit about how the fact that the state and your administration was so focused on elevating educators, I believe is the name of the area that you focus on. The fact that we were so focused on this sort of had us ready to go when the COVID funds came in. Can you just talk a little bit about sort of that preparation?
Well, when the pandemic hit in Illinois, we were in the process of developing our agency's strategic plan, and we had already conducted extensive stakeholder engagement with listening tours across the entire state. We landed on three central goals: student learning, learning conditions, and elevating educators. So when the pandemic hit, we paused and revisited our draft strategic plan to ensure that it contemplated students' needs resulting from the pandemic and remote learning, such as the digital divide and strengthening social emotional supports, and of course, supporting and retaining our educators through a very difficult time. So we aligned our federal pandemic relief dollars with the goals in our strategic plan so that we would be supporting initiatives that were sustainable and informed by stakeholder engagement.
Yeah, those two things, stakeholder engagement and sustainable, I think are going to be, they're important now and they're certainly going to be important in the future. So Dr. Ayala, can you just take a dive into, there's several, four or five, maybe six initiatives that are sort of teacher focused. Could you just talk a little bit about the ones that were supported by the COVID funds?
Sure. The first one I'll highlight actually four programs that we're using federal pandemic relief funds to strengthen our teacher pipeline. So the first one that I'll mention, we have allocated $13 million to support virtual instructional coaching and mentoring programs for our first and second year teachers. You know, these teachers missed out on the typical teacher preparation experience and started their careers in the midst of a global pandemic. So this program aims to give them that extra support. And I'm really excited about this partnership. You'll hear more about it next from our IEA partner. The second area, we're dedicating $5.6 million of our ESSER set-aside funds to provide grants to school districts to implement research-based strategies to improve the retention of our special education teachers. Now, this grant will provide priority to school districts that have low special education teacher retention rates and/or high numbers of special education vacancies. The third area, we launched a $4 million grant to recruit more bilingual educators that has already received a tremendous response. Now, these funds will provide financial support for educators currently working on short-term licenses as they pursue full bilingual licensure, or educators with a full license to wish to add a bilingual or an ESL endorsement. And the last area I'll talk about today is that we've dedicated $2 million of our ESSER funds to launch affinity groups, particularly for teachers of color, in partnership with Teach Plus. And this is intended to provide a space for our educators of color to convene and collaborate on issues facing them in the profession. Our data shows that three-year average retention rate for Black teachers, for example, is 81%, and for white teachers is 87%. The best way to get more diverse educators into the profession is to do better at keeping the ones that we have. So these federal dollars are helping Illinois strengthen our teacher pipeline in ways that will benefit schools and students for years to come. So we've made huge strides in bolstering our teacher workforce in Illinois. The stress and hazards of the pandemic threaten to undo so much of that progress. And so investing in our educators is key to pandemic recovery. But as the pandemic made so abundantly clear, there is absolutely no replacement for the teacher in the physical space of the classroom in order for students to learn and grow.
What's so great about that is the way that you just used the COVID recovery funds to focus on exactly where you knew the problems were in the state, the special ed, teacher diversity, ELL. I mean, I just love that. So Audrey, let's maybe turn to you now. And the first thing that she mentioned was the virtual mentoring. And this is a very unique partnership between the state and the unions, which is interesting in and of itself. But before we go there, maybe just tell us a little bit about the program. And before you said that, just one thing I want to note is that there was a lot of energy, I think, in the beginning for all these cool new things that we could do. We're going to be so innovative. And schools were just overwhelmed with trying to, you know, get schools open every day. And so there really wasn't as much, quote, innovation as maybe people thought there might be. But this is a very unique and interesting, innovative program. So just tell us a little bit about the program.
Sure. So thank you. And thanks for having me here. The Virtual Instructional Coaching and Building Mentor Program is different because we are able to match very precisely a virtual instructional coach to a new teacher. So for example, and it's all because we have Illinois learning standards. So we're all teaching to the same standards. So your instructional coach can actually be a very appropriate coach, even though they're not in the same district. So, for example, if we have a chemistry teacher in rural Illinois, where they might be the only chemistry teacher for 90 square miles, we can match that person with a chemistry teacher in the Chicago suburbs. So that was part of the impetus for this, is that I had been very involved in a previous state mentoring and induction program that relied heavily on face-to-face mentoring, releasing teachers. And it, quite honestly, it wasn't scalable, nor was it sustainable. So I had been thinking about this for a long time, that we want to do something that's both scalable and sustainable, so we don't go into these dips and all of a sudden we have a teacher retention problem on our hands. If we can keep something sustainable, then, you know, we can kind of mitigate those big dips. So the virtual instructional coach can coach up to four new teachers at the same grade level or department. We expect the virtual instructional coach to work approximately 5 hours a week. They can do that in small groups, but we also expect them to meet with the individual teacher. We also put them with a building mentor, because as important as the virtual instructional coaching is, it's also really important to know what's going on in your district, your schools, what are the expectations, what's the evaluation system, all kinds of other things. So we do that as well. And because we try to really honor their work, and we pay them decent stipends. We pay, depending on the number of coaches they take, we pay $700 a month, or we pay them $600 a month, which really does honor their work. And for some of our people, it means they're not working a second job. I mean, that is like they're. And we have a very rigorous selection process. We work with a group of stakeholders to come up with an application process, rubric, application questions, references. So it's a high bar to become either a coach or a mentor. And then we also pay the new teachers a stipend. We pay them $500, and we want to honor their commitment that they are making to their new profession, as well as to their own excellence. And so we think that's really important as well.
Audrey, so this wasn't something that just sprang out of your head the minute COVID hit. You had been thinking about this for a while. So it was almost like, as awful as this is, that the COVID was almost a catalyst, or the recovery funds at least were a catalyst to make this actually come to life. Just say a little bit about sort of being in the right place at the right time and how important that was.
Well, I will say that I remember talking to Carmen in September, pre-pandemic, and we were talking about this program. And at that time, I will say, we thought it was innovative. Little did we know that as of March 2020, it became a necessity. So we had been thinking about this. This was not something that we had just come up with. And so, Carmen and I and our president, we had been having conversations about this all along. So when COVID hit, at first we were kind of like, okay, what do we do here? I mean, we all stopped because everybody was working 24/7, but it wasn't very long till Carmen had, what was it, two times a week started daily. She was talking to all the stakeholders almost daily in the beginning. Then it was two times a week. I mean, it was, we were in constant contact, which we were so appreciative of. And it was Carmen's idea who said, look, I want to spend some of this COVID money on trying to retain our teachers because they are having, we knew teachers were just having a really difficult time. So that's, we had been in conversation, COVID money came, and Carmen said, seems like a good use of those dollars.
I don't think it's an accident that Carmen used to be a teacher and Audrey used to be a teacher. So you guys knew what was happening in the classroom. Audrey, really briefly before we turn to Amber, can you just say a little bit, another thing I love about this is you are doing some evaluation of it. Just say a little bit about what the early, it's only been a year, year and a half, just a little bit about what you're seeing.
So first of all, Digital Promise is doing the outside evaluation and they're still completing this year. And so we have early results from last year. And I just want to say a couple things, which was really interesting to me. So the coaches showed statistically significant improvement in efficacy. The coaches, these are people that we knew they had a high level of efficacy already coming into the profession, but they participating in this, going through the training, being reflective about their own practice while they're talking to new teachers, it lifted their efficacy. High percentages of new teachers saying they intended to come back to teaching, it was over 70%. And also new teacher efficacy on things like engaging students in both virtual world as well as in person.
Great. So now the bell of the show here, Amber, let's turn to Amber. So Amber, you were in this virtual mentoring program last year. So I want to ask you about that. But first, can you just say just a little bit about your school to give us a sense of what it's like at your school?
Sure. So I am at Gilson Brown Elementary. There are two other pre-K classrooms here, but it is mainly kindergarten through first grade. Our preschool program is actually divided up among a few schools in our district. So in a couple of years, we'll actually be back together. Yay, all of us in one building. So yeah, there are three preschool classrooms here, but then the rest is kindergarten, first grade.
And are you in an urban area, rural, suburban?
Suburban.
Suburban area. Okay, great. So tell us a little bit about your virtual mentoring experience.
I have truly enjoyed the mentoring experience. I feel that I've been matched with a great mentor. We meet once a week through Zoom, but we reach out multiple times a week sometimes to just check in, to share ideas. And she's just been super supportive and super helpful with giving me ideas for my own classroom. I've also enjoyed the fact that we do a new teacher forum once a month through the program. The last one we did was on the evaluation process, which was super helpful. And we've done one on self-help. So there's quite a few perks to the mentoring program.
Can you just say a little bit about, I think Audrey, I'm not sure if it was Audrey or the superintendent that mentioned this, that for many of the first year teachers, the student teaching experience was cut short during COVID, or in some cases didn't happen at all. Can you just talk a little bit about like what that experience was like? And then you're in some cases thrown into a classroom, you may have been virtual when you started. Just talk a little bit about how you felt that first day when you were taking over the classroom.
So I started student teaching January 2020, so kind of before, you know, it really hit the United States. I was able to student teach about 5 weeks in a pre-K classroom. My student teacher was super supportive. She, you know, kind of showed me the ropes of how she ran her classroom. And then about a week and a half in, I took over. Well, then I had about a week and a half break before I was supposed to start in a first grade classroom. And then that's when everything was shut down. And so in order to get, you know, all of us who were going through this education program to graduate, I'm sure universities across the country were scrambling trying to figure out what we could do. So we watched a lot of videos, we wrote a lot of papers, and essentially that was the second half of my student teaching.
Yeah. So I imagine your first day in the classroom, that first day was a little bit frightening to say. Yeah.
Absolutely.
I know we're at time here. Let me just ask you one last question, Amber, which is, are you, you're a second year teacher now. Are you in the program again? And I'm just curious, you know, your what it's like the second year being in the program.
It has been a great experience. I've truly enjoyed it. I always feel like there's always room to grow. I don't think even, you know, the seasoned teachers know it all. So just being able to have dialogue with other people, whether they're local or, you know, halfway across the state, bouncing off ideas, asking for suggestions, it's just beneficial all the way around.
Well, great. Well, good luck to you for the rest of the year. I'm sure it has not been an easy year. And I want to thank Amber, Audrey, and Dr. Ayala for joining us today. Great conversation.